Hello viewers, welcome you all on my YouTube channel. Today we will discuss the concept of free consent under Indian Contract Act 1872. So friends, the free consent is very important factor for a valid contract between the parties. If the parties are not entering into contract with their free consent, with their will and desire, then it is not a valid contract. So free consent is very important concept from your exam point of view as well as from your knowledge point of view. The word consent derived from Latin word consentire, which means agreement. So whenever parties are coming together to give and take something, it is expected that the parties will enter into an agreement with their free consent. But sometimes it may not happen so. So it will hamper the validity of contract. Consensus ad adam is a Latin maxim, which means consent at the same time. Whenever parties are entering into an agreement, such agreement should be without any burden or without any pressure. It is expected from the parties that they will enter into an agreement according to their will and wish. If an agreement is entered by party under compulsion or under threat, all such contracts are voidable or void. Now we will discuss the definition of consent. What is meant by consent, friends? Consent is defined under section 13 of Indian Contract Act 1872, where when two or more persons are said to consent when they agree upon same thing in same sense. So friends, according to section 13, when two or more persons said to consent when they agree upon same thing in same sense. So this is very important from our contract perspective, that the persons who are entering into contract must agree. Means there should not be a difference between the understanding of the parties. Whatever one party wants to convey, same shall be accepted by the other party. If not, then it is not a valid contract between the parties. So this is section 13 of Indian Contract Act 1872. Now we will analyze the section 13. So section 13 provides some essential elements or analysis of definition. Two or more persons said to consent when they agree on same thing in same sense. This is very important, the thing that the parties must agree on each and every aspect of contract in same way. There should not be a variation between them. It is called as consent. Section 14 provides that consent is to be free when it is not caused by. Section 14 of Indian Contract Act provides that consent is free when it is not caused by. So it is given in negative sense. It has not provided that when consent is free, but it states that consent when it is not free. So there are five essential requirements under which consent is not free. These are coercion, it means threaten or pressuring the parties, section 15, undue influence, section 16, fraud, section 17, misrepresentation, section 18, mistake, section 20, 21 and 22. So friends, we will discuss these five elements in detail, because according to Indian Contract Act 1872, free consent is necessary for a valid contract, and if these five elements are present in any contract, then such contract is voidable or void as per the provisions of section 15, 16, 17, 18 and 20, 21, 22. So we will discuss this one element one by one in detail. First, we will discuss section 15, definition of coercion under section 15 of Indian Contract Act 1872. So definition is provided under this section 15, which states that committing to threaten or threaten to committing act forbidden by Indian Penal Code 1860, unlawful detention or threatening to detain any property with intention of causing any person to enter into an agreement, unlawful detaining any property of any person. So friend, this is a section 15's definition, where it states that if a person is threatened or is likely to be threatened, and if a person is compelled to enter into a contract, then it is coercion. And whenever coercion is there, so in simple words, coercion means threatening. Threatening may be to the life of a person or a property of a person, whatever it may be. So it will be treated as a coercion. Now we will analyze this section 15. Threatening to person or property. So threat may be given to the person, his body, or sometimes a threat may be also given to property. Threat regarding the destruction of property or to kill a person, or various kinds of threats can be given, and it comes under the section 15, that is a coercion. Act forbidden by law. Whatever act done or threatened, it should be forbidden by Indian Penal Code, then only section 15 will applicable. Unlawful detention of a person is also comes under the definition of section 15, that is coercion. And lastly, unlawful detention of property. Sometimes movable or immovable property of a person may be threatened, and a person is compelled to enter into an agreement. So such is not expected to Indian Contract Act 1872, and under these circumstances, the consent of the party is not free. It is caused by the coercion, and the party whose consent is caused so can take an objection to such contracts within 3 years from the date of entry into contract before a competent court in India. Now friends, we will discuss some important examples of coercion. First example is threat to kill, threaten to cause hurt, threat to commit rape, threat to defame, and threat to destroy property. So these are some examples by which a person may be threatened or coerced, and if it is so, then it is a coercion, and the consent of the party is not free. Friends, we will discuss now some landmark judgments on coercion. Chikamma Amiraju versus Chikamma Sheshamma, AIR 1918. This is very landmark judgment of Privy Council of India, where a person induced his wife and son to execute a release deed in favor of his brother in respect of certain property claimed as their own by wife and son. If no, then he will commit suicide. So wife and son executed release deed. Later on, it was challenged as void. So under this case, it was a very landmark judgment of Privy Council of India, where a person has threatened his son and wife. For what purpose? He threatened that he will commit suicide if his brother is not released from certain debt which was taken by them. The Madras High Court held that the release deed is void as consent was under coercion, because Section 309 of IPC at that time defines attempt to commit suicide is an offence punishable for imprisonment up to 1 year. So it was a fit case of coercion, because a person, the wife and son, was under coercion. Their consent was not free. Friends, we will discuss another case law, that is Ranganayakamma versus Alvar Shetty, Madras, 1889. A Hindu widow was forced to adopt a boy under threat that her husband's corpus dead body would not be allowed to remove to cremation. She adopted the boy. Later, she filed a suit for cancellation of adopted deed. So friends, under this case, a widow was forced. It was threatened by the community members that they will not allow the dead body of a person to cremate unless and until she will adopt a boy. So it was clear-cut provisions of coercion. Because due to this thing, she adopted the boy. The Madras High Court held that the adoption was not valid as her consent was obtained under coercion. Because Section 297 of Indian Penal Code provides that if a person obstruct dead body of a person from being removed for cremation would be guilty of an offence under this section. So this is also a very landmark judgment of Privy Council of India. Now, friends, we will discuss Section 16, definition of undue influence under Section 16 of Indian Contract Act 1872. A contract is said to be induced by under influence where relations subsisting between the parties are such that one is in a position to dominate the will of the other and that position on an unfair advantage over the order. This is order, friends. It is not an order. It is mistakenly written. And please mind it, friend, that under section coercion, under section 16, it is mistakenly written here. Just correct it, and it is a undue influence under section 16. So now, friends, we will analyze the definition or what are the essentials of section 16. Undue influence is another factor which hampers the contract between the parties. Whenever a contract is there between the parties, it should not be undue influenced. Means a party to a contract shall not influence the other party, shall not made an impact of his personality or his position on the other party. If so, then such consent is not free. Sometimes it happens, friends, that one party is in a dominant position whereas other party is inferior to the other party. Sometimes due to this dominance position, contracts are entered because inferior position persons don't have any other way but he have to enter into an agreement. But later on, he can challenge it before a competent court. So, according to Section 16, what it requires? It requires fiduciary relationship. The relationship should be fiduciary. It should have some trust relationship. Then only Section 16 will applicable. One party in a dominant position. For example, master and servant. Master is always in a dominant position, whereas servant is inferior to him. So, whatever contract took place between the parties is hampered by the undue influence and the party can take the objection to it. Actual use of position to enter into contracts. The person who is in a dominant position must have used his position to enter into contract. Then only it is undue influence under Section 16. If it is not, then the consent of the party is not free. Other party is inferior to earlier. So this is very basic requirement of Section 16 undue influence, that one party is in a dominant position whereas other should be inferior to him. And last one, the fiduciary relationship we have discussed is already. Examples of undue influence. So undue influence is a immoral force used by one of the party against the other party. So there are some examples where there is a possibility of undue influence. That is advocate and client, doctor patient, employer employee, police accused, religious advisor devotees. Philip Lucca versus Francis Association AIR 1987. This is also a very landmark judgment of Supreme Court of India because it deals with the concept of undue influence. So what is undue influence? A person gifted his all property to a father of a church. We know that a church is there and churches are governed by fathers. Father of a church assured that he will look after him and her mother Later, it was challenged as void. So, father of a church promised to a woman and her daughter that the father or church will look after them, and under this pretext, they gifted all his property to the church. Supreme Court of India held that court contract under undue influence, and the consent of the party was caused due to undue influence, and contract is void. Landmark case. So friends, now we will discuss some landmark judgments on undue influence. Srimati versus Sudhakar, AIR 1988. A illiterate lady transferred her property to person who she treat him as her son. The son persuaded mother to gift the property. A gift deed was registered in favor of son. Mother was not treated well by her son, so she filed a suit for cancellation of gift deed. So friends, in this case, a illiterate lady, she was living alone in her house and she don't have any issue. But a son who was living nearby, she treat him as her son, and son forced his mother to gift her property. A gift deed was registered in favor of son. Later on, son neglected the mother, so mother filed a suit for cancellation of gift deed. Supreme Court of India held that there was nothing to show undue influence to dominate the will of lady, so gift deed is valid. So friends, under this case, Supreme Court refused to treat it as an undue influence, because the basic requirement for undue influence is the one party should be in a dominant position, whereas other party should be inferior to him. So in this case, this illiterate lady and son, they were not dominant or inferior to each other, but they are at equal footings, we can say. So section 16 will not applicable in this case, and the gift deed which was registered in favor of son was valid. Now friends, we will discuss the what is difference between the coercion and undue influence. Coercion, use of physical force or threaten, use of moral force or psychological force. This is basic difference between these two things, that coercion is possible through physical force only, whereas undue influence is possible through use of moral or psychological force. Second, act is forbidden by Indian Penal Code. May be committed even outside India. The coercion may be committed even from outside India, means a person may be threatened from outside the peripheral boundaries of India, dominating the will of another, and it is within India only. Undue influence is not possible from outside India. It may be against third party, and undue influence is possible required fiduciary relationship between the parties. So these are the main differences between the coercion and undue influence. And last one is the section 15 defines coercion and section 16 defines undue influence. So this is the basic difference between the coercion and undue influence. So in case of coercion, there is a threat to property or a person directly. Sometimes a detention of property may be also there, but in case of undue influence, one party is in a dominant position which hampers the will and wish of the other party. And this is a basic difference between section 15 and 16, that is a coercion and undue influence. Thank you friends for your kind listening. If you like this video, please share it with your friends and fellow colleagues. Thank you for your kind attention.